Hachette Audio presents To Build a Better World, Choices to End the Cold War and Create a Global Commonwealth. Written by Philip Zelikow and Condoleezza Rice. Read by Arthur Morey. Introduction. Catalytic Choices. Two East German success stories. One of the new countries created by the Cold War was called the German Democratic Republic, GDR, or more informally, East Germany. It was the Communist Germany. With its 16 million inhabitants enjoying some of the highest living standards in the socialist world, as the year 1989 began, the GDR seemed solid as a rock. The standard text on East Germany said that it is apparently one of the world's most stable regimes. To pick one kind of GDR success story as 1989 began, consider a scientist, a woman who had established her position in a field founded and dominated by men. She was a researcher working in the GDR's Central Institute of Physical Chemistry, a part of the country's Academy of Sciences. She had received her doctorate in physics a few years earlier. In some ways, it was not a difficult job. She did not have to teach. Hardly anyone outside a small circle of fellow scientists could even understand what she did or evaluate her work. Her field was the study of quantum characteristics of subatomic particles. The scientist was the daughter of a small-town Lutheran pastor and a former school teacher. Her friends used to call her Kazi. Her last name was Kosner. The communist government did not care much for pastors, but Kazi's father, who had moved from a parish in West Germany to East Germany in loyal obedience to the Lutheran church hierarchy, had stayed out of politics. He eventually headed a Lutheran seminary. Kazi's father had always been carefully monitored by the efficient and omnipresent East German secret police, the Stasi, short for State Security in German. Informers reported that Pastor Kosner appeared to adopt the Communist Party line in the internal politics of the Lutheran Church. He was certainly willing to critique capitalist greed and consumerism. Life was not always easy. Kazi's hard-working, meticulous father would tell fellow seminarians how he had left the West out of free will and about how hard he had worked, and he nevertheless was convinced that all was in vain and that the church, even in his lifetime, would shrink and most parishes would lose their pastor. Kazi's mother could not take up a teaching job. She knew how to teach English and Latin. The East German government had little interest in hiring women to teach those subjects, especially not in a small town. The government set income was below average, but Kazi's family made their way, occasionally getting gift packages and money from their relatives in the West. Kazi was a gifted student in school. As expected from a star student, she had joined the Communist Party's youth organization. She wore its uniform with its instantly recognizable indigo-blue colors to school. She won prizes. She studied all the time. The only foreign language taught was Russian. Kazi devoted herself to becoming fluent in it, enjoying Russian culture. Her other star subject was mathematics, where she was good enough to do well in national competitions. While Kazi was young, the family could vacation and visit relatives in West Germany. That changed when she was 7 years old. When she returned from an August 1961 holiday in Bavaria, East German soldiers were unrolling the barbed wire to fence off the border for good behind what the government called its anti-fascist protection wall. Kazi remembered how, in church that Sunday, people cried. My mother cried, too. We couldn't fathom what had happened. Later, in 1968, her parents were upset by the Soviet-led invasion in Czechoslovakia, a country her family had visited. The invasion crushed that country's experiment with socialism with a human face. As a schoolgirl, Kazi was no athlete or social standout, but she had friends. She was well-organized and helpful to her classmates. Her skill in the Russian language won her a trip to Moscow. She received a place in an elite high school. Again, her grades were excellent. She was invited to go on to a university and receive a rare, prized higher education provided by the state. At the last moment, though, the precious opportunity to go to a university almost collapsed. With her graduating high school classmates, Kazi joined in staging for the school an anti-imperialist school play. The expected theme would attack the American war in Vietnam. Instead, the students, in a sort of end-of-school rebellious way, performed a play praising the anti-Portuguese liberation movement in Mozambique. They even worked in a quote from a satirical writer who vaguely alluded to a wall. Those in charge were not amused by this play acting about liberation and references to a wall, like the one that now enclosed the East Germans. The school authorities planned to punish all the students by taking away their university admissions. They had used such a punishment before. Kazi's father and other well-connected fathers all desperately pulled strings to get the decision turned around. They succeeded. The student's teacher lost his job, but Kazi was able to go on to the University of Leipzig. She had originally thought of studying medicine. Instead, she decided to concentrate on physics. This was a field as far from politics as she could possibly get. Naturally, she had to take her required classes in Marxist political economy. She also did a little work on the side as a barmaid in the student watering hole, the Thirsty Pegasus. 90% of her classmates were men. One became her boyfriend, then her husband. As a married couple, it was easier to persuade the state housing office to assign them an apartment. She and her husband both pursued advanced studies. His field was optics. She stayed with physics. At an initial job interview, the Stasi recruited Kazi to become an informant. She would have become one of millions planted in practically every workplace. Kazi dodged this duty. She found a way to put the Stasi recruiters off without getting in trouble. My parents always told me to tell Stasi officers that I was a chatterbox and someone who couldn't keep my mouth shut. And I also told them that I didn't know if I could keep this secret from my husband. She did manage to keep at least one secret from him. It was a big one. He was quite surprised when, suddenly one day, she packed her bags and left the apartment we shared. The couple had grown apart after a few years together. Kazi kept her husband's last name, by which she was now known. She completed her doctoral work in 1986 after 8 years of not too hurried postgraduate research. She published an article in a peer-reviewed Western journal, Chemical Physics. Again a single woman, childless, she made a quiet life for herself. The GDR did not have much resources and infrastructure for lab research in subatomic particles. She and her friends at the research institute, including a skeptical fellow physicist with whom she became close, would frequently talk politics. They were not political people, but they were attentive. Kazi was not outspoken, but she was observant, she was careful, and she had a dry sense of humor. Being scientists, she and her friends had unusual access to books and travel, although their activities were carefully monitored. She was even allowed to make a trip to the West to visit West Germany. In the late 1980s, in private conversation, she and her friends would analyze the arguments of East German dissenters. These dissidents were usually in prison or exiled to the West. Their books were banned in the GDR, but illegal copies were smuggled around. Kazi and her friends also would discuss the unrest and martial law in nearby Poland, which they had visited. They would discuss the fascinating news coming out of Moscow about the reform plans of the Soviet Union's new leader, Mikhail Gorbachev. With her Russian, Kazi could herself read the Soviet newspaper Pravda to dissect the latest developments. She and her friends could usually tune into a West German radio station or TV if they were lucky enough to share a TV. As 1989 began, the 34-year-old scientist had her usual routines. She took bike rides on country roads. She had her weekly sauna and drinks with a friend. She did nothing to worry the Stasi, nothing to call attention to herself. The head of her department at the research institute thought she was a good worker. "One gets the impression," he said, "that she is on to something. She works diligently toward a goal, but she is also a woman who has a mind of her own." As 1989 began, Another young professional was carving out a successful career in East Germany. He was an intelligence officer. He worked on the Stasi's side of the street. He and his Stasi friends were making a good living watching the East German people and any foreigners who happened to be passing through, including the Soviet troops and civilians based in the country. Though he was not German, this particular watcher was fluent enough in the German language to be able to pass as one. "I have two natures," he would say, "and one of them is German." With his wife and two baby girls, he was living in the East German city of Dresden.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.